all of the seminal papers on that. And this is, but we're still trying to work it out, really. And we're also, of course, we understand that class, caste, and gender don't exhaust the sources of inequality. There are many other sources of inequality also. How does one begin to think of inequality in an integrated, multidimensional fashion is both a theoretical and an empirical challenge for us. So this is trying to maybe take one small step a little bit further. What I'll be doing is, first I'll just, I won't spend much time on introducing the problem. I'll try to show some results from the 66 NSS survey, which will, I think, substantiate my claim that there is an intersectionality. And then I will go on to asking what can be some key concepts, some key tropes which cut across different forms, different systems of inequality, which if we pay attention to them, perhaps we can make some further progress. Okay, in this paper, now there are many ways of looking at intersectionality and understanding inequality. In this paper, we explore one particular way, which is that of examining social inequality through analytical concepts, which while central, may not necessarily be isolatable in a real world. This permits us to identify several different sub-processes from different systems of inequality, which may actually be acting together. We may benefit eventually from an analytical reformulation of the categories of social inequality, asking how they are actually integrated with each other across particular systems, or even whether they form a larger and more general system, integrating specific ones. The integration of our understanding of different forms of inequality would help in our ability to delineate and counterbalance how structural injustices operate. The task of constructing such an integrated view of multiple systems of inequality is obviously a long and onerous one. At this early juncture, perhaps it may help to push it further, another step, by pointing to certain specific overlaps and divergences between the particular systems. A review of how caste, class, and gender have been formulated, which I will not present right now over here, but is part of a larger work, suggests that there are several analytically distinguishable moments or tropes within each, some of which are actually expressing the same processes. Caste may be said to be made up of endogamy, cultures of hierarchy, not necessarily Brahminical, but possibly others also. But under the shadow of occupational and political grouping, classes are shaped by work relations, consumption patterns, and occupations, and these are in turn influenced by kinship networks, by gendering, and through cultures drawn from occupational specialization or other community-based processes. Gender itself is shaped by the compulsions of reproducing work relations and of maintaining power within the family and other social institutions, gaining some of its character through gendered subcultures. That these are interwoven may be substantiated, would be substantiated, I hope. Naturally, statistics doesn't prove anything, but to some extent. Through the NSS 66th round, which I'll just show some slides about that, which was a study, which was a survey conducted between 2009 and 2010 with about 1 lakh households. The use of survey data, we know, must be done with great caution. Apart from a host of issues relating to sampling, any survey tends to count only what its categories are able to theoretically imagine. The extended debates over women's work and who is or is not an OBC are examples of how that theoretical imagination may be shaped. Further, large-scale surveys like this one tend to represent only what is relatively easy to count. Whereas we know that many of the most important aspects of social reality can only be recognized through sensitive processes of dialogue and interpretation across cultures. Yet, it is submitted that such surveys do provide certain advantages. They provide advantages of scale, of generalization and comparison, which even multi-site ethnographies are still struggling to move towards. In my presentation, I shall present certain broad contours at the outset using large-scale survey data sets, but then my later discussion would be basically drawing from ethnographic and smaller scale studies. Now, due to time limitations, most of the examples I'll be using will be from tertiary or higher education. And there's a reason for that. Primary and secondary education certainly is also deeply influenced by our political economy, by our culture and institutional processes. They filter who goes on to tertiary education. However, the most obvious connections between education and social inequality actually are visible at the tertiary level. To the extent that education shapes adult roles of privilege and power, that is primarily through tertiary education. Educated classes in India are defined by tertiary education and not so much by secondary or primary education. The number of people moving to a tertiary education of 17.2% or so is a rather small fraction of Indian youth. However, these are the children of the topmost sections of the stratification system. If you're talking of the top sections of the stratification, this is it. And they are the ones who will occupy most, not all, but most of the higher strata of status, power, and wealth. Of course, education is not alone responsible for differences of rank and political power or the inheritance of wealth. Further, we know that tertiary education is highly differentiated. There's a huge gap between Delhi University and ordinary colleges in small towns. All these caveats are there. And yet we look at tertiary education mainly over here, because it is submitted that this will tell us something significant about power and status in this country. Now, let me just start by one slide, which is, if you look at the enrollments in undergraduate colleges, as revealed by the NSS survey, now, the very last column is what the young people of that age group are in this country at that particular period of time. But when we see it getting filtered into different kinds of tertiary education, very clearly there's a huge deal of social inequality coming in. Now, this first slide focuses on caste. My second and third slides will try to show that caste alone is not enough to capture that inequality. We need to look at other forms also. But one of the most stark differences comes out that, for example, if you look at the STs, in the population, they may be 8.5%. In that particular age group. But when you look at engineering colleges, they're just 0.7%. Similarly, if you look at the SC, they may be 20.4% in the sample, but in engineering colleges, they're just 5.3%. Now, there's a different kind of pattern depending on the kind of stream one is talking of. Engineering seems to be showing the most stark inequalities, but this is caste alone. Now, when one puts class alongside it, I'm going to skip right now the extended discussion of what one means by class, how is one formulating it. I'll skip that for the moment. But if, let's just look at the first group, which is, let's call them the owners, managers, and professionals, the upper white collar workers. And we see that within a particular caste group, you find a great deal of differentiation, and there's a lot of difference amongst the castes. The others or the upper castes, the largest occupational group within them is owners, managers, and professionals. Whereas if you see the ST, the other extreme, it's just 3.5% of the ST families are in this particular class. So there is a huge caste difference. But if you see representation within engineering colleges, now this slide is only about engineering colleges. I misread that. That's 18, let me repeat that. Amongst the upper castes, 18.4% are in the upper white collared wage labor, not 52. That's when one looks at engineering students and upper caste engineering students, we find that in engineering colleges, 52% of the students are actually from one particular class. But if you move to other caste groups, the proportion of that goes down. Several very interesting things can come out of discussing this. I'm just pointing out one thing. My point is that if I look at caste alone, I don't go very far. I have to differentiate caste groups within within that. I have to differentiate occupational groups also, you know, because as you can see, who is the largest group within largest occupational group in engineering colleges cannot be understood only by caste. One has to club with it the class background of the family also. Similarly, you will find that when you look at gender alongside this, these are slides of the OBCs and the so-called upper castes, whom we otherwise called others. Let me just walk through the, let's look at the bottommost. Now, one can look at each one of them and see the dynamics. Let's look at the bottommost, the agricultural workers. This one. One thing to notice is whether there's a caste difference. There is definitely a caste difference over here amongst agricultural workers. Second question is that, is there a difference between different classes? Definitely there is a difference. And within that, one also finds a third layer of differences here, which is that of gendering over here. If one is to interpret the very bottommost line, it is that amongst the OBCs, the number of men in the sample of this age group are 17.7% of all the men, whereas in engineering colleges, we find only 4.7% of the engineering college men are from OBCs. From agricultural worker backgrounds. Whereas if you see women, the proportion of women is substantially less than the proportion of men. Again, we see this huge difference between women in the entire population and women in engineering colleges, but it's much worse than the position of the men. And this is within that little box of agricultural worker OBCs. One can go on like this. The point I'm trying to make in this is that A, a lot of ethnographic work has been telling us about intersectionality. It also is coming up more and more at statistical levels. The problem is how to understand it. Why is this happening? And what are the kind of processes that we may point to which are responsible for this? Now, it is possible to propose, for analytical purposes, at least three central tropes which can be helpful in seeing the connections and disjunctions. There are both connections and disjunctions. There are disjunctions because these are three different systems. They are not one system, they are three different systems. So there are connections and there are disjunctions also between various systems of inequality. Now, those three tropes I'm suggesting are these, which is the question of work, the question of kinship, and culture. An analytical focus on these three tropes might help to identify intersectionality and trace its pathways. These tropes cut across all the three systems of class, caste, and gender, and hence offer a way of seeing them in an integrated manner. They do not replace the need to understand each system on its own, but highlight and draw our attention to what it is that is common across the various systems. A central trope cutting across the various forms of inequality is clearly that of work and occupation, affecting the expression of class and caste, as well as the way gendering takes place, though each of them in a somewhat different manner. Work itself is shaped through several processes coming from different origins. It may be influenced, for instance, by the logic of capitalist development, which may involve acquiring an exploitative form or becoming the object of exploitation. Or it may be shaped by occupational specialization, as the need to cultivate technical skills over several years. It acts as a basic shaper of life experience and is an active ingredient of all forms of social inequality. Specific castes no longer nowadays share internally the same identical work pattern, but there are still pronounced caste linkages to various occupations, not least because of the inheritance of property. Often what appears to be a caste trend is actually the expression of its class relations. Thus, the other castes' overwhelming presence in technical education nowadays may not be the consequence of its caste ideology, as much as the fact that it dominates already the educated wage labor of contemporary India. The drive to make the current generation into higher level educated wage labor is at least partially that class's attempt to reproduce itself and maintain, if not improve its position vis-a-vis other classes. Similarly, the trend within these castes to support the higher education of their daughters may also be at least partially a process of reproduction of the class itself. Apart from one of the main features of gender being a separation of spheres of work, it also takes up specific forms according to the kind of work being reproduced. The patterns of work in one system may echo through the way inequality is shaped in other systems, leading to a common thread uniting them. It may also happen that occupational processes may introduce divergent rather than convergent trends into caste and gender processes. These systems of inequality are not homologous and contradictions are inevitable. For instance, the aspiration to join the educated wage labor through education may lead to weakening a caste identity whose ideology is based on agriculture and landlordism. It may similarly cause an accelerating tension with the traditional homemaker's role as more and more educated women with jobs provided by the degrees are discovering. Gender identities may pull away from the logic of occupations in the growing economy, or may color them in unique ways. A second central trope is that of culture, seen as loosely integrated symbols and practices that plays a crucial role, although in different forms. The forms which it may take up in a market, a caste society, and a patriarchy may all be slightly different, or substantially different. And yet it is possible to see some connecting processes. It acts, among other things, to organize social groupings, which can be quite dynamic in a market society with an emphasis on openness and meritocracy so as to permit a continual reconfiguration of resources and processes. This may resound through caste cultures, leading, for example, to a greater ideological emphasis than previously on being flexible according to the era one is in, and thus justifying and encouraging participation in new educational opportunities. Cultures of elitism, originating from the history of certain castes, may influence the stratification system in another way. They may interweave with the belief of being special and provide a boost to those who imagine themselves as superior in studies, and encourage them to orient themselves even more closely with academic goals and processes. Conversely, caste identities that see book learning as alien may contribute to identity processes that slow down students' acceptance of school authority and may lead them to internalize a sense of being rebellious or weak students. Gendered beliefs in male aggressiveness may lead to classroom processes that encourage boys to participate and girls to be passive listeners. Cultures of class, caste, and gender may pull in opposite directions too within education. Patriarchy and caste's ideological emphasis on maintaining a stable rank order is basically in a state of tension with the market's pull towards recombining resources and moving them to new positions through education, among other things. Caste and gender cultures often resist the messages of consumerism, which are today an important and growingly important driving force of the new recombination of educated labor in liberalizing India. On the other hand, cultures of individualism may reinforce market inequality while destabilizing traditional forms of both caste as well as gender. These would have corresponding consequences on aspirations for various levels of education by young people and for what they expect education to eventually provide them. cultures may also serve as boundaries of exclusion in the most advanced of capitalist firms. The boundaries sometimes acting as a useful resource for group functioning and simultaneously as an obstacle for recruitment of new diluting group members. This makes it often, not always, often, it may be the basis of excluding both women and other ethnicities and castes from the circles of power. Caste and male cultures invisibly form a substantial part of the cultural identity of many groups that first get formed in highly competitive schools and colleges. These cultural identities define who joins an informal group and who is kept out of it as not quite the right sort. The third central trope here is that of kinship, which refuses to disappear even in most advanced capitalism. It shapes, among other things, the inheritance of property and of work cultures through the form, though the form that it may take may be different in aggressive corporate circles with the mantra of meritocracy, in comparison with the kind of explicit support it gets in the context of the need to maintain social rank in caste, and in the context of an acceptance of gendering amongst men and women. Kinship bonds deeply impact the distribution of cultural knowledges and practices, which provide the ability to use the education system to access higher positions in corporate and state bureaucracies. Children of educated wage labor, more often of certain castes and more commonly male, would be familiar with the phrase told to them repeatedly by fathers that if you don't study, how will you eat? For many young men, this becomes a milestone in the formation of their identity as a committed and enterprising educated wage worker. The way to hold oneself vis-a-vis others, cultivation of a love of reading, learning to negotiate and get the attention of teachers, so and so on. For all these, one important site where they are learnt is in the family and in intimate circles. The obscurity of the roots in kinship, when you talk to them how they picked up, they don't know. But much of it is coming up through kinship circles. The obscurity of the roots in kinship for the self-consciousness of these groups is not an obstacle to their effectiveness in actually distinguishing who gets ahead in competitions. For women, meanwhile, the importance of marriage as a social goal keeps kinship relations a central influence in their lives. It is they who must carry the bulk of the burden of reproducing and maintaining kinship bonds, often translated into reproducing caste cultures and caste identity. This deeply influences their ability to access and stay on in education, and also the kind of subjects and eventually class positions they may aspire to. Kinship becomes a site of enormous tensions where the other two tropes of occupation and culture intersect it. The need to reproduce the class of educated wage labor is an important force pushing families to look for suitable matches outside the old caste networks. This causes kinship networks to break and take up new forms in ways which we are still struggling to understand. The individualism of the educated wage labor clashes with the expectations of kinsfolk that older collective traditions be maintained. Women are often the ones who have to negotiate both the old and the new and try to somehow keep the bonds alive. At the same time, for women from white-collar families, the pressure to keep their existing occupation going through teaching their children and keeping them focused on educational success may become a site of new tensions and split loyalties. Each of these moments is integrated into particular systems, like those of gender or class or caste, and shows patterns which express that systemic integration. The cultures of hierarchy, for instance, take up the idiom of purity and impurity within Brahmin orders, serving to express and reproduce the caste structure. What the above suggests, however, is that it is also useful to draw them out and speak of these tropes in isolation, which is in a purely analytical sense of isolation. Doing so helps us to explain and understand the ways in which different systems of inequality meet and also how they diverge. The culture of hierarchy thus can see ideas and values merging with those coming from patriarchy or from class inequality, with the ideologies of caste, and reinforcing them. Or at times it can also contradict them. For example, what may happen when children from trading castes begin to accept the values of open competition and meritocracy, you know, an uneasy truth gets struck in their minds, with a hybrid interpretation of meritocracy, which is both hierarchical and exclusionary, and also open at the same time. These tropes serve to draw patterns that cut across the parent systems of inequality. We may find that kinship leads to strong synergies between class, caste, and gender by virtue of its shaping social networks and the boundaries of marriage and affinity. This may lead to strong boundaries emerging in social groups, even under capitalism, which serve to keep individuals locked in and unable to access knowledges and support systems that are necessary for a higher education. Similarly, they may make available role models and guidance which teach how one is supposed to build the daily rhythm of study and revision so as to get higher marks in board exams. And yet, the systemic character individually of class, caste, and gender may still persist. The way kinship, for instance, is treated by different systems. Let's look at the divergences also. Kinship, the way kinship is treated by different systems is an important point of divergence between them. Classes in contemporary capitalism emphasize an openness and allocation of roles on the basis of apparently achieved abilities, whereas the caste system sets strong lines which cannot be crossed on the basis of birth and relationships of blood and marriage. The influence of kinship on deciding roles and relationships is even stronger when it comes to women. Nepotism and family bonds remain an important tension point, therefore, in contemporary societies. The fundamental values of contemporary education systems rest on this contradiction in values that achievement and merit are supposed to be the decider of roles, not blood. You know, and yet we find that blood and marriage continue to be significant factors. Just, I think, another 5 minutes. Can I have 5 minutes?
You will have only 5 minutes for discussion.
Oh dear. Okay. Right. So let me let me read one of the examples. No, that's all.
Maybe you can just conclude by saying something.
Yeah, okay. I'll just maybe talk of one particular example. Among the possibilities which emerge when one starts talking of what are the convergences between systems of inequality. Okay. Just one paragraph, last I'll read out of this. A disaggregation into tropes to recombine them into a composite understanding of inequality also helps us to see the significance of the entry of women into higher education in higher numbers. This is not necessarily an expression of emancipation of women from the traditional gender roles, though that too may be a slowly growing process. To understand this trend, we can point out that while agriculture is stagnating in India in comparison to the service sector and to informal manufacturing, leading even farmers' children, but only those with sufficient incomes to afford it, to turn to an education that has little to contribute towards reproducing their own kinship groups' traditional occupations. This is creating a demand for a new set of abilities to reproduce the emerging new class position. The more a group is oriented towards education and white-collar work, the greater the emphasis on education as a means of reproduction of class, and consequently a greater acceptance of the seeking of education by women from these groups, which is the new class culture which is being aspired to, whose cultural reproduction it remains women's responsibility to perpetuate. Women begin to enter higher education alongside men in rising numbers, but that is not necessarily a statement of liberation, being more an expression of a transition from an agricultural or an artisanal social reproduction to the social reproduction of white-collar work instead. I'll just conclude by suggesting that A great deal more work is required, obviously, both theoretically and empirically, on trying to understand intersectionality. But if we begin to disaggregate the components of existing systems, they don't actually, not in reality, they don't, in reality, they continue to be integrated in certain ways, but conceptual disaggregation may be one way to go to ask, what is it that is connecting them up? And what is it that is not connecting them up?
Thank you. Thank you, Vaman.
Yeah. I'm so sorry all the time interrupting. You are very interesting intersectionalities. So I'm so sorry for this. We'll come back. And this, I was under the wrong impression that, you know, you are suggesting there is a linear way of caste progressing towards its own annihilation. But it is not the case. That's what you, I'm very happy that you didn't conclude that way. I want caste to be the interesting object of understanding and analysis. So, but I'm sorry, but we'll have about 10 minutes to discuss this paper. Very, very complex paper, developed in a very, very complex way. And you are very comfortable when you're doing this. So, questions, comments, questions, brief. Maybe we can have 4 questions. Yes, please. Here.
Yeah, so thank you for that, Aman. I wanted to ask you about something that may or may not be within the scope of this paper, but you might have some thoughts on it. As more and more women enter higher education, my understanding is that they enter from the higher caste and class groups, broadly speaking, into higher education. A lesser number of women come from the more depressed caste and class groups, I mean, very broadly. On the other hand, men from the depressed castes and classes are making it in smaller numbers into higher education. What are some of the contradictory consequences of this imbalance within the higher education sector? What do you think?
It's very much related. You can collect some questions. Yes, please.
I'll just show that slide again. If
this is one of the slides. As a person who came to numbers late, I find that they help me in certain ways. If we look at what are the numbers of men and women coming in and as percentages, it's a different picture in different kinds of caste groups. If we see people coming in this, the upper castes themselves are a very large number, probably. I don't have the offhand, I can't remember numbers, but if you see the others in different kinds of institutions, in only engineering are there more than 50%, you know, 58. Whereas in the ordinary kind of colleges, and there's a huge range of shades in different kinds of institutions in India. In others, which is arts and science colleges, it's something like the upper castes, so-called upper castes, are about 40%. Now, within that, we find further differentiation into classes. So, when I read this, it seems to me that it is in the most elite institutions that we find that upper caste we should not call them upper class, but educated wage labor, professional educated wage labor families predominate. You know? And exact figures of that, proportions of that are not very forthcoming, but that's where it really is happening. As we go down the hierarchy, where most people are admitted, it's quite a different picture over there. Yes, I'm sure this will be causing many kinds of it contradictions. It opens up. This is part of what is responsible for many of the cast glass ceilings. It's also creating very interesting possibilities of interaction over there. But yes, I can't say much more than that. It really asks what we really need are good ethnographic works trying to explore these things.
Thank you, Aman. Thank you, Aman, for a very insightful presentation. I wonder, I mean, you presented aggregated data. Is it possible to desegregate this data and on a regional basis so we can see how different movements, such caste-based movements or different political parties have made an impact and how caste, gender, and class intersect? For instance, I'm just thinking of UP or Tamil Nadu. Or so, is it possible to see the footprint of different movements in data?
Yeah, thanks. It is certainly possible. I have not done it, but it should certainly be possible. I can't think of. Any other study which has done that, either right now or offhand, I can't think of any other such study. But the data is easily available. It is possible to do it. We have a lot of anecdotal of the impact of this, particularly in states like Tamil Nadu, which seem to be having done a very interesting work over the last 50 years. And a contrast between this and the situation in something like Uttar Pradesh, which is also a state of OBC assertion of a particular kind.
Yes.
You know, which is also the Tamil Nadu situation.
Yes. So,
but no, I really don't know of any good studies of this myself.
Perhaps,
but the data is available if you'd like to take a look at it sometime.
Okay, thank you.
Any last question on this particular presentation?
Thank you, Aman. I was just wondering from whatever data you've shown here and also talking about Tamil Nadu, there does seem to be a massive shift in the whole occupational thing among various, a cross-section, I would say, traditional occupation, shift in the whole traditional occupation. Does your study somewhere show that this has also helped to break some of the caste factors or changes over there and move them out of certain occupations and move them into certain some other sort of levels, even among women and class levels, for instance, moving them from one section to another level? Would there be any such movement possible?
Yeah, I think that movement is certainly happening. But this has to be also, spoken of statistically, in terms of proportions. Otherwise, one way of talking about it, you know, the danger for us is that we say, yes, movement is happening. But how much? If after 60 years of, or whatever, years of independence, if we find that the students who are in, engineering colleges are still very heavily disproportionately, so heavily disproportionately from certain castes, that proportion has gone down over 60 years. 60 years ago, perhaps they would have been 90%. Today, they may be perhaps 50 or 60%. Yes, that has happened. The exciting question here becomes, what are the policy measures? What are the kind of institutions which need to be built, which will hasten that process? And we find many other countries have done this much faster than us.